Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. The NASA Space Agency is preparing to launch a spacecraft that will approach the Sun more closely than any man-made technology in history. NASA's Parker Solar Probe, a robotic spacecraft intended to explore, among other things, the mysteries of the solar wind and the enduring puzzle of coronal heating, will approach within less than 4 million miles of the Sun's photosphere, or what is sometimes referred to as the Sun's surface. For decades, within the Electric Universe community, our scientists have proposed a radically alternative model of the Sun, based on principles of electrical engineering and plasma physics. Today, retired professor Dr. Donald Scott outlines the opportunities for the NASA mission to test the predictions of the Electric Sun model.
NASA has been talking for several years about their solar probe. This is a space probe, really, that is going to go as close to the Sun as they can get it without melting it. The vehicle is due to be launched about August 11th. And the only reason I thought maybe we should talk about it a little bit here on the Space News is that there are some things that are very good about it and some things that I think are sort of overblown about it. So let me just sort of give you a mind dump from this end as to what I think about it. The mission is scheduled to last about 7 years, and it's going to use a slowdown technique of using Venus to slow it down. And so on these various orbits around the Sun, it will approach more closely. But NASA says it will, quote, fly through the Sun's atmosphere. Well, now that right off the bat depends on how you define the extent of the atmosphere, because the particles in the so-called solar wind travel out as far as the heliopause, and that's about 18 billion kilometers. That's more than three times the distance to Pluto, and that's really the Sun's atmosphere, using one definition. But I don't think they're talking about that. They're talking, I think, about the atmosphere as far out as the corona. Well, that presents a problem, actually, because this morning's NASA press release says that the Parker Solar Probe will, quote, touch the Sun. I think we recognize that as overblown rhetoric, and it's designed to impress the public, but it doesn't lend confidence to anybody who wants to take their press releases seriously. Be that as it may, the vehicle is going to get closer to the Sun than any other man-made object has ever gotten, and the orbit of the probe will be closely restricted to the ecliptic plane. That is to say, it'll go around the Sun, and essentially around the Sun's equator. So anything that's going on over the Sun's poles, such as these very important, to me at least, coronal plumes or coronal streamers, these long, thin, twisting streams of current and magnetic field that extend outward from the Sun's north and south poles, those are possible sources of the electrical charge flow that maintains the Sun's positive voltage. Well, we aren't going to learn anything about those from the Parker solar probe. But anyway, NASA says that the probe will get within a distance, when they really get down to saying it, of about 4 million miles from the Sun's surface. Now that's about 9 solar radii. That is, if you look at a picture of the Sun and put an imaginary dot right in the middle of it, the distance from that dot out to the what looks like the surface of the Sun, it's the so-called surface of the photosphere, it's the closest in surface that is not opaque, so that photospheric surface, you can't see through it. So we talk about that's the Sun's surface. But that 4 million miles that the probe will get within is 9 solar radii. So if you measure from that dot out to the edge of the Sun and then go 9 times that distance, that's as far in as this Parker probe is going to get. Well, the farthest out that the corona extends is about 5 solar radii or so. It varies with the time of the quiet Sun and the active Sun, but it gets about 3 to 5 to 6 maybe at most out from the surface of the Sun. So my point is the Parker Solar Probe is not even going to get close to the outermost regions of the corona. So this is a far cry from, quote, touching the Sun, unquote. However, it's a lot closer than we've ever been before. The power density radiation that's coming out of the photosphere of the Sun is in the neighborhood of 6,000 watts per square centimeter. So if you put your fingers and make a little square about 1 centimeter, that's about roughly a half an inch by half an inch, and think of 6,000 watts of electric light coming out of that by 1 square centimeter. That's a lot of power. So at a distance of 9 solar radii, which is where the probe is going to get to, that radiation power ought to be about 74 watts per square centimeter. And you say, well, that's not very much. 74 watts per square centimeter? Well, yeah, but you realize there are 10,000 square centimeters in a square meter. So that means that that solar probe, the heat shield on it, has to either absorb or reflect some 740,000 watts per square meter. That's a lot of energy, a lot of power, energy per unit time coming at that thing. So NASA says they're expecting a temperature of around 2,500 Fahrenheit. Well, okay, so I guess the main, get down to brass tacks, what can the Parker probe measure? We've mentioned some things that it can't measure. Well, one of the things I hope it can measure, and I don't know whether they will program it or be interested enough to do it, is there are these things called coronal caps. If you look at a nice picture of the sun when it's in solar eclipse, you can see these triangle things. Some people say they look like dunce caps. Other people say they look like wizard's caps with streamers coming out of them. But there are these triangular things, and there's so easily half a dozen or more of them, usually around the sun. Why do they form, these coronal caps? Why do they form? Well, we in the electric universe know very well why they form. They're due to the tendency of plasma to form filaments. When plasma leaves the sun, it doesn't go radially outward, or like if you spread the fingers of your hand and look at the angles at which your fingers go out. Plasma doesn't go out like that radially. It goes out and then comes back and joins in together and forms these triangles, these solar caps. I'm hoping that the Parker probe might be able to get close enough to take some pictures of those solar caps and get the detail of what they look like, because those caps may very well be the origins of the Birkeland currents that connect out from the sun to the various planets. We have, of course, one to Earth. There's a gigantic one out to Jupiter, another one to Saturn, to Neptune, to Uranus. And so if they can ever get pictures of what those condensed plasma streams, some people call them magnetic flux ropes, look like, that would be very nice. This probe is going to carry a wide-field imager. It's called WISPR, WISPR. That WISPR might get some pictures, I'm praying, might, of the first pictures we've seen of up close a Birkeland current stream. Well, anyway, one of the announced goals of the mission is to identify the cause of coronal heating. This coronal heating effect astronomers have been worried about that for decades. Why is the lower corona 2 million degrees, whereas the photosphere surface of the sun right below the 2 million is only at 6,000? And so that's pretty mysterious. It's been that way for decades, and they are desperately trying to find out why that occurs. We in the electric universe, we know what causes it. It's caused by collisions of electrically accelerated ions coming out of the top of the photosphere tufts and going slamming into the bottom of the corona. Those collisions create turbulence, and turbulence is measured as temperature. So this happens right above the surface of the photosphere. That's at 1 solar radius, not 9 or 6 or whatever. So the Parker probe will be unable to reveal the cause of coronal heating because it can't get to where the action is. It can't get to where the effect is happening. So keep your eyes peeled for any new hypothetical, non-electrical explanations that fall out of this. I hope that they don't do that, because they will be imaginary if they are. The cause of the coronal heating and the temperature minimum, so-called, of the sun is way beyond the capability of the probe to see it. The probe is instrumented to be able to measure electric field strengths, though, and magnetic field strengths. An instrument called SWEEP, WSEAP. That stands for solar wind, electrons, alpha particles, and protons. That instrument can measure the velocity, density, and temperature of those particles. And that would be very interesting to get measurements of those particles. and see how closely they fit into the Arctic Sun model. I suspect if they do make those measurements, they will probably be surprised, and I'll be very happy, I hope. There's another instrument called ESAS, and this will also measure the properties of the solar wind particles. And NASA's description says this will, quote, help determine which of several theorized mechanisms causes the particles in the solar wind to accelerate. Now, that is not possible if you stop and think about it. Because if you measure, however accurately, the velocity, the density, and the temperature of a particle or a bunch of particles, that tells you nothing at all about where they came from. You can take a picture of an automobile flying at a high speed down a major highway, and somebody says, well, why is it going that fast? And somebody says, well, it's got a high RPM gasoline engine. And the other guy next to him says, no, it's got a high torque electric motor. It's a Tesla, you know. That's my sort of half-humorous attempt or attempt at half-humor to say that you can't, by taking an instantaneous measurement of a velocity or even an acceleration, determine why this thing has the properties that it does. What got it going so fast? You can't tell. You can tell it's going fast, but there's no way to say that this will determine this measurement, which of several theorized mechanisms caused the particle's acceleration. Anyway, we ought to hear about lots of data being collected, lots of these images being taken, and what particles were seen in the solar wind. I'm praying that we do not hear that they have observed magnetic reconnection one more time, because it's nonsense, and I think eventually they will come to realize this. But what will be very interesting, or any measurements interesting to us in the electric universe, are any actual physical measurements of electric field strengths, current densities, particle velocities and accelerations, and also measurements of the filamentation I was talking about. And the reason is because astronomers have long maintained that plasma cannot support an electric field. Well, then why did they instrument the Parker Solar Probe with instruments that can measure electric fields? Because they've put out of their mind the possibility that electric fields can exist in plasma. And by golly, there's one thing is sure, they're going to be flying around within a tremendous amount of plasma and trying to measure the electric fields there. I suspect they will indeed measure electric fields there. And I don't know how they're going to cope with that, how they're going to explain it. I'm confident because in SAPPHIRE, the SAPPHIRE laboratory experiment that we have here on Earth, they have measured electric fields of upward of 8,000 volts per meter. And so if they do measure any electric fields out there, it's going to be interesting to see how they explain them away. Anyway, every day that the Parker's probe survives this wildly hot environment that it's going to pass through is a testament to the professional expertise of its designers and the engineers who created it. I feel very strongly that it's going to be a marvelous engineering feat. But the official NASA interpretations of any data it manages to send back must be filtered to exclude fictions such as magnetic reconnection and open-ended magnetic fields and shock waves in non-collisional plasmas. If there's no collisions, how can there be shock waves? Well, there's a whole bunch of things like that that NASA seems to be fond of dredging up and throwing at the public that we have to be aware of. This new NASA probe has the possibility of making some new, very useful measurements, provided that everybody realizes that the actual restrictions inherent in its abilities are what they are. Anyway, we await the reports with bated breath, and we're also armed with a rational skepticism of overreaching assumptions that may be proposed as factual causations that are not.